Workshop. So in this session, we'll be covering the concepts of APIs and how to design APIs. What is Django REST framework? So all those things we'll be learning in this last day of this workshop. So I hope the whatever things we have learned in the last 2 days, I hope you all remember this. So because we'll be starting from, we'll be picking it up from the next, the same thing from today. Okay, let's start. Let me share my screen. Okay, can everyone see my screen?
Yes, sir, it's visible.
Okay. Yeah, thanks. So let's start the session. So first we will see what is Django REST framework. So before we start Django REST framework, so I want you to let you know what is REST and what is SOAP. So basically whenever you create an whenever you do some API development, web development kind of thing, so basically there are two types of architectural patterns. One is REST and another is SOAP. So I'll explain one by one. So REST full form is representational state transfer. So that means that REST is a stateless kind of architecture. That means, so in REST architectural pattern, whenever you send one request, so that will be independent of another request. So that means that, so whenever you send two different requests, each of the requests will be independent of each other. So one request will not get to know that what is happening in another request. So all the requests are independent and the whole request response cycle is independent of each other. That's why we call REST as stateless, because we are not maintaining the state of the request anywhere in client or server. And REST permits different data formats such as plain text, HTML, Excel, JSON, etc. But the most preferred format that we will use, and the most preferred format we also use in Django is JSON. I hope all of you are aware of what is JSON and what is XML and how those formats are work. I hope you guys are aware. If you don't, then please ask me. I'll explain those also. Okay, now if we have to speak about SOAP, so the full form of SOAP is Simple Object Access Protocol. So in SOAP, unless the REST, we can maintain the state of each request. That means if you send two different requests, so each request can hold the information of the another request. That means, so whatever happening in one request, that state we can easily transfer to the another request. That's why we call SOAP as state maintain level. So while REST is stateless, okay. And another main difference is SOAP can only work with XML format. So it cannot work with any other format we discussed just now, like plain text, HTML, XML, JSON. So it will only work with XML format. So these are the main difference. So in Django, we commonly use REST as architecture pattern. We don't use SOAP because REST nowadays, REST is so popular. That's why we use REST in most of the web frameworks. So I will show how it works. So that's why we have a package in Django called Django REST framework. So which provides the package to build the web API. So I'll explain what are the features that Django REST framework package provides. So first thing, so it provides a web browsable API. That means you can write an API and you can test the API in the browser itself instead of Postman. So Postman is a tool, Postman is an app where you can test your API. Like once you write an API, you can test whether the API, whatever you have written is correct or not. That you can test in Postman. So most of the web framework, if we use Postman as a testing tool, but In Django REST framework, it provides a web browsable API itself. That means you don't need Postman. You can test your API inside your web browser also. So that is a one feature that is getting that is provided by Django REST framework. And if I have to tell another feature, that is serialization of data. So that I'll be explaining in next slides. And it also provides authentication policies such as OAuth, token authentication, and basic authentication. So this also we will explain what are the different types of authentication, how to do it. And the another feature is, so it provides the routers for effective URL handling. That means it will automatically generate URLs for each view. Since yesterday, if you remember, we had created, we had looked at the urls.py. So how to map view with each URL. So in Django REST framework, you don't have to do it. So it will automatically take care of that URL to view mapping. I'll show you how things are done while I'm coding. For now, I'll just explain one by one. Okay, first we will see what is serialization. So serializers is a feature in Django REST framework that allow complex data types such as query sets. So yesterday we saw what is query set. So query set is a result of a query. So it's a type of query set class. Yesterday we have seen while working in Django shell, if you remember. So that is a separate data type. So in serializers, we can easily parse query sets and we can convert into Python data types such as list or dictionary or anything so that it can easily render into JSON, because in JSON, we can render only string or integer. We cannot pass any other data type apart from string and integer into JSON, because that's how JSON format works. It can parse only string data type and integer data type. It cannot parse any other data type such as query sets and any other class, any object. It will not parse that. So to make the query sets parsable, we use serializers. So it will automatically convert these query sets into Python data types such as string, integer, list, dictionary, so that we can easily render it in JSON. So this I will show you how to write in serializer. So here, if you see, I have given an example. So yesterday we had created one book model, right? For the same model, if we have to write a serializer, the serializer will look like this. I'll also explain what are each of the terms when I'm coding. Right now, you can only see how it will be done as a serializer. This I will explain later. Okay. And next, we will learn more about HTTP. Before writing any API, you should be knowing how HTTP protocol works. So HTTP full form is Hypertext Transfer Protocol. So we use this protocol while working with any web browsable API, because whenever request response, the whole format works, it will always happen through HTTP protocol itself. Please remember that. And in HTTP protocol, it provides five main different methods. So there are multiple other methods also, but these are the five methods that are pretty much important. So I'll explain one by one. So first one is get. So get method means, so you are fetching some information from the server. So whenever you want to fetch something from server, that means something from the database, then in that time you always use get. And the second one is post. Post means if you want to add some data into the database, that means if you want to create some data and add it to the database, that time you will use post method. And put method means if you want to modify all of the attribute of a table. Suppose if you see here, assume that here in author table, if you want to rename all the attributes such as first name, last name, and age, in that case, you will use put method. Okay. And delete method, by the name suggests, so it will use whenever you use delete method, whenever you want to delete some specific resource and some specific row from the table, that time you use delete method. And the last one is patch. Patch method is similar to put method, but the main difference is in put method, we modify all the attribute of a table. But in patch method, we only update some partial modification. That means we only update partial things. Like it will not update all the attributes of a particular data row. We'll update only few information. We'll not update the whole information of the row. So that's the main difference between put and patch. Please remember this. Okay. Next, so this is all about request. So whenever you're requesting server, whenever you send some request from the client, that means you are from your web browser. So these are the five methods that are possible. And there are multiple other methods also, but these five are important. Okay. Next, we will see about response. So now you have already sent the request. Okay. Now processing is going on inside your Django server. Once the processing is done, how the Django server will respond? So that will be determined by these response status codes. So the earlier what we talked about requesting. So now we are talking about response, how the server will respond once the request is received. So in response, there are mainly four types of different responses. I'll explain one by one. So first is successful responses. For that, we always use codes. We use some status codes for each kind of different responses. For successful responses, you should always use from 200 to 299 status codes. So these are integers. And if you want to redirect to any some HTML template or any other browser URL, in that cases, you should always use from 300 to 399. And if there is any some client errors, that means if your server, if your client hasn't requested properly. So if they send some wrong data, in that case, you should always notify your web browser by sending 400 to 499 status codes. And assume that your web browser has made the valid request, but there is some issue in your API itself. That means there is some issue in the Django server itself because you haven't written the API properly. In those cases, you should always throw 500 to 599. So that's what I have mentioned here. So for successful responses, so you should always send 200 OK. That is 200 is determined to OK. That means whenever a client makes a valid request, you should always send responses 200 with OK status. And assume that when our server makes a request to create some data inside the database, which is post request. So whenever server makes a post request to create some data, in that case, so it's a successful response itself, but we are not sending 200, we are sending 201. So that's the main difference. So here we are fetching some data from the server, that's why we are sending 200 and OK. But here we are creating some data. So usually get will be associated with 200. And post will be associated with 201. Because in get, you are fetching some data from the server. That's why server is returning 200 response. But in post, you are creating some data. That's why it will always return 201 created. And let's see about this client error thing. So assume that your web browser has made a wrong request. That means it didn't request properly because server hasn't understood the request. In that case, you should always throw 400 bad request. That means whatever request you have made from the web browser, that is not valid. And that is not proper. You should make a valid request. That is the meaning of this response. And if you send 401 unauthorized, that means the whatever request you have made, that is from unauthorized user. So this unauthorized, we have already discussed in authentication versus authorization. So assume that you haven't even logged into your app, but still you are trying to send some request to the API without even logging in. So in that case, client, the server should always throw 401 because the user hasn't even authorized to use this app. That's why we are sending 401. But assume that server has already, the user has already logged in into the app, but that user has no permission to make this request. So this is with respect to authorization. So 401 is with respect to authentication, and 403 is with respect to authorization. The user is valid. He has logged into the app, but he has no permission to make this request because he is not an admin user. Only admin. So assume that there is an API call only admin user can make. In this case, if non-admin user comes and if he makes that same API call, then we should always throw 403. 403 forbidden, because you are forbidden to do this request. You shouldn't make this request because you are not you don't have permission. That's the meaning of 403. And in case of server errors, so assume that client has made a web browser equal to client. So web browser client or anything that if they made a valid request, but you whatever the logic you have written inside your API is wrong. That's why you are not able to send some response. In that case, you should always throw 500 internal server error. From this, we will get to know that there is some issue in the Django API that we have to fix by seeing this error code. Okay, so this is the meaning of all this response status code. I'll show you all the different response status codes. Yeah, see here, I have shown you only few status codes, but here you can see there are a lot of different status codes, but these all are not required for you right now. So here for 200, starting with 200, there are these many status codes that are possible. And with respect to redirects, there are these many status codes, response codes are possible. And with respect to client error, you can see there are a lot of errors, different errors that are possible. So these are mainly used to identify what is the issue, whether it's an issue from browser side or whether it's an issue from server side to easily debug. So we will use these different types of status codes. And if you see server error, you always start from throwing 500 to 599. So these are the different server errors that are possible. So server errors means there is some issue in Django itself. Client error means there is some issue with respect to your client. That means browser, because you are not sending the request properly. And these are successful responses. That means everything is proper. Okay. Okay. So if there are no doubts on this, let's move to next slide. Okay. Yeah. So yesterday, now we have learned like how to write queries and all, but we didn't get to know that how to write and view. View means it's the main thing in the Django where we write all the business logic. So in order to create some API, you always should use API view or view sets. I'll explain one by one how each are different. So API views are nothing but it's a common class based view. So that is exposed to write an API. So I'll show you how the request and response looks like. And it supports all the basic HTTP request methods that we discussed just now. All these methods are supported in API view. Okay. And the same way, view sets also the same thing we use. It will also work as the same as API view that takes a request and do some processing inside the view, and it will return the response. But the only difference is in view sets, we will use some routing mechanism, but in API view will not use any routing mechanism. That I will explain while I'm coding. Okay. Now Next comes pagination. I remember yesterday one of you had asked questions about pagination, how to fetch the data with respect to the page number. So this I'll be going to cover in this slide. Okay. So in REST, Django REST framework, it supports multiple types of pagination things. So in those pagination styles, I'll explain two of the main paginations that we use. So this is called, so first of all, pagination is need, I'll explain why pagination is needed. Because assume that you have an entry, you have a table, the same way I explained this thing. So take this table, author table. Assume that you have 10,000 entries in author table, and you are making a query to fetch all the authors. That means author.objects.all. Then what happens? So it will have to traverse the whole table, and it has to fetch 10,000 entries of the author. But if it gives the response of all the 10,000 authors at the same time, how will you display in your browser all the 10,000 data? Because your browser is not capable of displaying all the data in the same screen, right? Because it's not even possible, because it has 10,000 names, author names. So in that case, what we can do is we can do pagination of the data. That means we will split the data into multiple pages, into multiple chunks of pages. That means we will decide that, let's say, okay, whether we will say that in one page we will display only 10 author names like that. So if you want to display 10,000 author names, then you need 1,000 pages. That means you need to split the data of chunks 10 into 1,000 pages. So this process is called as pagination. By doing this, what you can do is you can save query time. So in Java, when you make a query, so Django doesn't have to fetch all the 10,000 data. It has to fetch only first page data. That means first 10 rows. So that's why time is also saved, and it's better to send only 10 data at a time, because the user can see only 10 data at a time, right, in one screen. So if he wants to see the next data, then he will go to the fetch, he will click on the next page. Otherwise, if he's not interested, then no need to send all the 10,000 data, because to fetch 10,000 data, it will take a lot of time, because it has to make query and it has to fetch each and every item, right, from the DB. So from doing pagination, there are two advantages. One, we are saving time by doing less number of queries. And the second thing is we are splitting into the multiple chunks of the data so that user can jump into any number of page. So any page. So from first page, you can directly go to the 500 page or 1,000 page also. That is also possible. So by doing this, we are giving flexibility to the end user. So in pagination, we have two different types of pagination in main. So one is page number pagination and another is limit offset pagination. So this page number pagination is similar to what I explained just now. So here we will split data into pages, and each page has one ID associated. So assume that if you want to get some data, okay, so in the same case, so if you now you want to get first 10 authors, then what you will do is you will pass one argument to this API and pass page number equal to 1 like this. Then if you pass like this, it will fetch only the first 10 entries. But in case if you change this page equal to 1 to page equal to 4, then it will fetch the fourth page data. That means author 31 to author 40. Because we have defined in each page, we are showing only 10 entries. So in the first page, we are displaying author 1 to author 10. In second page, we are displaying author 11 to author 20. And in third page, we are displaying from author 21 to author 30. And if you give page equal to 4, then it will give the results of all the author names from author 31 to author 40. Okay. So whenever your page number pagination is used, you should always use this parameter page equal to, you should pass some integer to get that page's data. Okay, this is the concept of page number pagination. And there is one more pagination that is called limit offset pagination. This is also similar to page number pagination, but instead of giving page equal to 4 like this, so here what we are doing is we are giving the flexibility to the end user itself. So what happens is, so in the page number pagination, here there is no option to end user to choose how many number of entries they can view in one page, because by default we have set it as 10 from our side, from Django side. But assume that, suppose if anyone comes and say, I don't want to I don't want to see only 10 entries in one page, I want to see 15 entries, or I want to see 20 entries on page. In that case, what you have to do is you have to change the code in your backend, and you have to set number of entries in one page from 10 to 20. You have to change that in your backend code. So that means whenever end user wants to change the number of entries in one page, then you need to make the changes in your API also. So this is time consuming, right? So to avoid that, what we use is we use limit offset pagination. So in this pagination class, so there are two parameters. One is limit and another is offset. So here you can see limit param will determine how many number of entries should be there in one page. So assume that by default, limit will be 0 and offset will be 0. Now, in the same way, so here if you pass page equal to 1, then you will get first author 1 to author 10. To get the same thing, so here what you should pass is limit equal to 10, because in one page we are displaying only 10 entries, and offset equal to 0. Offset means the starting index, because from 0th row we are fetching the data, and we are fetching 10 entries, that is determined by this limit param. Offset is the index. So if you use offset equal to 0 and limit equal to 10, you'll get the, it is equivalent to page equal to 1. I hope you are getting it. So page equal to 1, whatever you're passing here, is it is equivalent to limit equal to 10 and offset equal to 0. So here you're passing that offset equal to 0. That means I want the index to be 0. I want from first row, and I want only 10 entries. So here, if you want to see 20 entries in first page, then no need to change anything from Django side. You can easily, you just have to change the limit from 10 to 20. That's it. Keep offset as 0 and keep limit as 20. Then you will get from author 1 to author 20. This is simple. And okay, then next see how to get author 21 to author 40. Then what you should do is, so author 21 to author 40 is how many entries? 20 entries, right? So your limit will be same, 20 only, but your offset will be going to change. So instead of 0, here you will be incrementing it by 20, because you have already fetched from 0th index to 19th index, 0 to 19 data you have already fetched. Now you want to fetch 20 to 39 data. That's why you should change your offset to from 0 to 20. You are incrementing it by 20, and limit will always remain same, because you want only, now also you want only 20 entries. That's why your limit will be going to be same, but your offset will be going to be incremented by 20. So if you pass limit equal to 20 and offset equal to 20, in that case you will get from 21 to 40 author data. Okay, yeah, this is the concept of limit offset pagination. So I hope you understood. So we have talked about what is page number pagination and what is the drawback of page number pagination, and how we are going to fixing it, how we are going to overcome that drawback by using limit offset pagination. The only drawback is here you cannot set how many number of entries you can display in one page. is because this will be statically fixed from Django side. So if the user wants to change, then you have to change it from your side. But here, the user can only set it in the API request by changing the limit. Okay. So these are the two paginations we are using. And let's start implementing these things one by one now. Okay. First, what we talked about is serialization. Now, I will show you how to write serializer. Okay, I think this is the previous chat. Okay. So now I am audible, right? So there is no issue. Hello. Am I audible?
Yes, sir, you're audible.
Okay, okay, thanks. Okay, let's start implementing these things. So first, I have talked about serialization thing. So for the same models, whatever we have created yesterday, let's see how to create a serializer. First thing what you have to do is you have to go to this book app where you have created your models and create one file, new file called as serializer. .py. The naming should be same. Serializer. Okay. Like this, you should. And now you should import your model from book.model. Import author and book. Okay, now let's import serializer. So this is a Django REST framework documentation page. This is super helpful. So if you find any doubt, the documentation is super here. So you can go to this DR. You can just type DRF in your browser, it will directly land to this documentation page. So here you can go through each and every thing, whatever I have explained in detail. So I'll be importing this serializer class. Okay, before we do that, we have to install this REST framework thing. We haven't installed it, right? Correct. So let's install Django REST framework first. Then only you can write your serializer. First, here, if you go to home page, they have mentioned how to install Django REST framework. So this is a package given by Django REST framework, but it will not be included by default in Django. That's why you have to install it manually. So like this, you should go and copy paste this. So Django REST framework is installed now. So here after installing, they have mentioned what you should do. Add REST framework to your installed apps. So whenever you install some third-party packages, you should add it in your installed app in settings so that Django can recognize. So yesterday, if you remember, we have added book whenever you created that book app. The same way, we need to add REST framework also so that Django can recognize that you have installed REST framework package. And you need to configure a REST framework. That I will do below. Okay, REST framework. like this you should configure. First, I will configure for pagination thing. So here, if you can see, I had mentioned about page number pagination thing. What is the drawback? So here you can see that I had told you that in page number pagination, you have to statically add how many number of entries you want to see in one page. So that is going to be added here. So if you can see here, I'm mentioning what is pagination class. That is, I will do page number pagination. That page number pagination. Not a limit offset pagination. I'll show you page number pagination first. And let's keep page size. So this is argument that will hold how many number of entries you are going to be displayed that are going to be displayed in one page. So let me keep it as some low number right now. Let me keep it as only 3. Okay. Let's see how it looks. Okay. Now this configuration is done. REST framework is added. It's added in installed apps, and we have added settings for REST framework. Okay, now I will write serializer. Okay. Now let me go to serializer file. Let me create a serializer class. Class author serializer. This is for author table. Okay. Now this should always be a subclass of this thing, serializers dot model serializer. Okay. Then we should define a class called meta where we can specify these informations. I'll show you what all these things. I'll explain. So in class meta, there are two options. One is model. So here, what in model, you are informing Django that this author serializer should point to author model. That you are informing by adding this line. And fields means what are the fields from author model you want to serialize, you want to parse the data. So let me see what are the attributes of author model, first name, last name, age. I will add that. So by default that ID will be there from Django, and I will add first name, last name, and age. So this completes the author serializer. I'll show you how it looks like when you serialize, but right now this is the way you have to create serializer for author one model. The same way you can create a serializer for book also, that you can do later. Okay, now after serializer, now you should create your view. So let me create a simple API where we are listing all the authors that are available, which that Django ORM query I have already explained, author.objects.all, that we will add it in this view. Okay. Let me create my view name as get all authors. Okay. First, to do that, you need to import API view. Okay, first let me import all these things. These are all are REST imported from REST framework, which that package we have installed just now. Okay. So it provides API view. Also, it provides object for giving a response. Okay. Now, all the APIs what we create should be derived from API view class. Okay. Then this is a class. Inside that, I have mentioned in the PPT that it supports only HTTP methods as functions, such as get, post, put, delete, and patch. So to create any API, then you should need to define that method the same way as we have mentioned in the HTTP method. So if you write get, everything should be small. If you write get, that means it will support only get method. In that case, if you write, sorry, not class, it's function. Define get will point you to get method, and define post. If you write post, then it will take only, it will post API. Okay. Now, so getting all authors, that means you are not. So here, if you can see, getting all authors will belong to get request, because you are fetching the author information from the database, but you are not posting any new author data from the API. You are just retrieving the data from the database. That's why it is always a get method. Okay. This is not a post method, because you are not adding, creating a new author. You are just retrieving the existing authors from the database. That's why this method should be always get, and it will be inside the class. That's why self, and it takes the object of request. It's a request object, and it might take some any arguments or keyword arguments. Okay, so this we are not sure. So that's why we are not sure that if we can pass any number of arguments to this function. That's why we have defined as arguments or any keyword arguments we can pass. That's why we have defined like this. Okay. Now, let me write my query. So you know the query, right? Now, what should I write in this query? To fetch all the author, whatever you have written in the ORM, right, shell, the same query you have to write it here also. So to do that, first you have to import the models. Book.models import author book. Okay. Now I'm writing the same query, whatever I had written in the my Django shell, author.objects.all. Okay. And I will declare one variable output, which is a list. Okay. Now you already aware what is the output of this authors. It's a query set, because it contains multiple data. Whenever you use all or filter, the result of the query will be always a query set. That means it contains multiple data. Whenever you use get, then only you will get a single object. This I had explained yesterday only. Okay. And to parse the query set, you should always use for loop. For author, in author. So if you see the same, whatever I had written in the Django shell, the same thing I'm writing it here. There's nothing different. Okay. The same thing I'm adding it in my business logic, my view. Let me append all the data output. I'll create a dictionary first. Author dict equal to first name. So you know this is an object. So to get the attributes, you should always use author first, and last name key will hold last name. third or last name, and age key will hold author dot age. And now you have got the author dict object, dictionary object. This you need to append to output. Output dot append. This is I'm appending the dictionary. So here you can see that what I'm doing is for each author, I'm creating a dictionary so that it can be parsable in the JSON, because it will not parse author object directly. The J, because this is a type of object, this will not be parsed by JSON directly. So that's why I'm converting it to the dictionary so that it can be parsable from in JSON. And I'm appending each author data to a output list. Okay. So my whatever I wanted to do in this view, that is done. So my view was get all authors. That means getting all the authors that are available in the database. And once it is done, I'll return the response. So this will always be included. So it should be included in response function. So this we have imported from this framework. Return response output. Okay. So this is one of your view. This is one of your API, the whole thing. Okay. So you have created a class, and it's you have you derived from it too, because you want to create an API, and you have created a get method because it should be get API. That's why you have created get method, and you have search from this, and you are parsing each author data, and you are adding it output and returning this response. Let's see how it looks like. Okay. Now you have added this, you have created this view. The next step should be you should map a URL with this view. So that can be done in urls.py as I explained before. So here you should import that view from book.views, import get all authors. So I have imported my view just now what I have created, and so here instead of path I will use URL because I want a regex information. Just a minute. I don't want path. I want URL. Just a minute. Okay. Okay. So instead of using path, I will use URL. So both are same only. The only extra thing that URL will do is it will support regular expressions. That's why I'm adding URL. So let me add a URL. So let me add it as get all authors. So this is my URL, and I'm mapping my get all authors view this with this view. So since it's a class-based view, so this is a class, you should always add, we should let you know Django that it's a class-based view by using this function. So since it's a class-based view, so you should always add dot as view at the end. Okay, that's this you can remember for all the class based like this. Okay, now let me save it. So now we have created your first API, and we have mapped it with our URL, and let me see whatever I did is correct or not. Three. me do run server. Okay, it hasn't thrown any error. Now let me check. So now I am into my home page. So here it's saying that page not found 404, because we haven't mapped any URL with just slash. So that's why it's a giving hint that so there is nothing to display in this path. You need to use either admin slash or get all authors slash. So admin is your admin interface. Yesterday we have explored this, right? So now let me use get all authors, because this is a view just we have created, and I'm sending a request to this URL from my web browser. See, so this is the output you are getting. So here the same thing, whatever I did, right? So I created a dictionary for each author, and I have appended it in the list of output, and I have returned that response. So that means it worked. So if you are able to see this information, so you have remember that we have only three authors, I guess. Let me check, cross verify from the admin panel. Yeah, so we have only three authors. The same thing, we are doing a ORM query and we are displaying it to the front end. So this is the API. So front end is making a request, get request to this web to this endpoint, and we are fetching the data. So here you can see that the status is 200 OK. That I have already mentioned. What server is sending? You see, successful response. 200, okay. Because this is, since it's a get request, we are sending 200, okay. If it's a post request, we'll say 201 created. Okay. Yeah, see. So let me add one more user query I have written, whether it's correct or not.
I will add one more author. New author.
Let me save it. Now there are four authors, and let's go to the views and see whether the information is now reflected or not. Okay, here you can see whatever query we have written inside our view, whatever query we have written to fetch the information from database, that is 100% correct, because the information is reflected here. So this is the API. This we call it as API. Front end is making a request from browser to the API endpoint, and this URL is mapped with this get all authors view. So once the URL is resolved, it will call the get all authors. Then this view will be called. Then this query will be executed. It will go to, that's what I called MVT template, model view template. It will go to view, and from this query, it will go to models.py and fetch all the information from the database, and it will send the response back to the front end. So this completes one request response cycle. Okay, you have sent the request and you have got the appropriate output in the JSON format. So this is JSON format. And you can see content type application JSON. That means the response type is JSON, and the status is 200 OK. Got it? Okay. So now we have learned how to write an API using API view. Now let's see the same thing how we can do using view sets. So I have mentioned two things, if you remember here. I have mentioned API view and view set. Let me try the same thing in view set, and I will show you how both are different.
Okay. Let me import my serializer also here. From serializer, import author serializer. Okay, now let me create my view set. Let me import the view sets and all.
Okay.
That is the import command. Okay. From REST framework, import view set and status. Okay. Now, let me write my first view set below this. This is also class author view set, and it will always import from model view set. View sets dot model view set. That's what we have imported here. Okay, it's a subclass of this. Now, we should specify these many parameters. I'll explain one by one. If that means this is equivalent to this query set, equivalent to what is the query you want to perform inside this view set. I will write author.object.auth, and the serializer class will point it to which serializer it should point. So this we have already created serializer, author serializer. We will point to author serializer because we are fetching the data from same model, author model only. Okay. Now, so your view set is done. Your view set is only this much. So this is a simpler version of the API view. I will say how it works. Now we can go to URLs and let me configure the routing for this thing. Let me import the router. And this import router. I'll use one of the router. Okay. Now to register this thing, we'll see. Okay. So this, anyway, I don't want to remember all this. Just that's why I'm copy pasting. Okay. So these are all are the syntax, so you should remember how to do it. So what I am doing it here is, so I have created a router to parse this view set to create the URLs by itself. So here what we are doing, what we are not doing is we are not creating any URL like this for this view set. So Django will automatically take care of this creating URLs. I'll show you how.
Let me add author. I will import view set also here.
author view set and I will map it to author view set. So now you can see. Okay, I think everything is fine. Just one more thing I should do, which is okay, registering this router. Okay, I'll explain what I did just now. So what I did is, so I have create where I specified what is the query and what is the serializer class it should point to parse the data. So this is a serializer I created. I have added these many fields inside the serializer. And now in the URLs, what I did is I created one router, which is default router that you don't want to, you shouldn't want to know like what is the difference between this routing and all. You can use default router. Okay, then what I did is I created a router object and I registered this view set, whatever I created just now, view set, to some endpoint. Okay, to authors like this. And the same router I have added to this view set URL here. I'm adding this router.urls because whatever, so router will take care of generating the different URLs. Those URLs, I'm adding it in URL patterns so that Django can recognize. So let me show you how it looks like. Okay. Now I will do. So you can see that there is one more URL came. This is view set, just now what I've added. Let me go to view set and let me see how it looks like. Okay, now you can see you have come to this view set. So now you have accessed this URL and it will point router.urls. Router means this object, and .urls, this attribute of the router class. And I will show you how it will generate the URLs. So here you have seen that I am registering my router in authors thing. So here you can see that it has already generated one URL for me to get all the authors. So that means this is my base URL, my local host. Okay, this is my local host URL. Okay, and view set is whatever I entered just now. And authors is I have added here. This I can make it as empty also. Okay, that is also fine. Okay, so it's not like you should give something like this. You can see. So it has already executed this get request. Now I'll revert it back to author and I'll show you again. Okay, so see whatever router I have created, it has already generated one URL to fetch the data for me. So this is not added from my side, though this is created by router itself. I'm just creating a simple router and I'm adding some URL, some random URL to this and mapping it to this view set. Now you can see let's see what happens if you click on this. Yeah, you can see the same thing, whatever I have given, but so let me keep it in side by side so that you can compare. I will show both API view as well as my view set. So can anyone of you can tell me the difference between these two? What is the difference you can see? Can anyone of you answer? Hello. Did you understand my question? Can anyone of you answer? It's okay if it is wrong also. You can try something. What is the difference you are seeing by these two outputs? Hello. No one wants to try. First of all, am I audible? Hello. Okay. Okay, so you are not seeing any difference in these two, but I'm clearly seeing few differences in the output for a different output format. Please observe the output and let me know what is the difference you are seeing in terms of keys, in terms of JSON. What is the difference you are seeing? No one wants to answer. Page. Okay. Yeah, correct. So that's correct. So here you can see there is an URL generated to go to the next page. That is correct. And what else? What is the difference? One more difference you can see. So here you can see that there is one more key called ID that is also passed in the view set, but it's not there in their API view response. The reason is, so in serializers here you have mentioned what are the fields you want to see, right? So you have, here you have mentioned ID, first name, last name and age, but in your view you are sending only these three. So now I will add ID also. Author, okay, I'll add it in the beginning itself. Okay, now I will refresh this. Yeah, so now you can see in terms of response both might seem similar, but there is one major difference here. Please count the number of entries that you are seeing. So this is equivalent to number of entries you have in the database, 4, and this is also 4. But here, if you are seeing that there are only 3 entries, what might be the reason for this difference? Can anyone want to guess? The answer is here itself. You just have to find it. Can anyone guess it? Why there is a difference of 1? So here you can see there are only 3 author entries. Where is the last entry? So here you can see that. So 1, 2, 3 ID of entries. So this is a primary key. So this will be the unique. And 1, 2, 3 will be there. And 1, 2, 3 are there. Where is this entry? Where has this entry gone? Can anyone wants to answer? Please answer. So if it is wrong also, then it's fine. Okay, next page. Yeah, so let me see. I'll click on this next thing. Yeah, correct. It's
in the next page. And okay, there is one more question now. So how come only three entries in the first page and one entry in the next page? How this has been possible? Where we have set this? How come there is only three? How come there is, why it's not two? Why it's not one? Why it's on exactly three? Can anyone answer that? Why it is not two and why it is not one? Why it's exactly three? That is my question. How did Django get to know that it has to display only three entries in the first page? Can you guys answer? This is simple. If you remember the steps what I have done till now, you will get, if you have seen everything, then you will get to know where we have configured this. Please try to remember all the steps I did from beginning. Please think and let me know. I'll wait for 1 minute. Let me see if anyone can guess. If you don't want to speak, you can mention it in chat also. If it is wrong, then it's fine. You can mention anything. You can give some reason. Whatever you're thinking. So I just want to know what you're thinking.
Sir, because of limit?
Where is that limit? Can you tell me where we have set that limit?
I don't remember exactly that. I think so because of limit.
Okay. Yeah, so whatever you have told, it's partially correct. I will explain. Yeah, so if you had remember at the beginning when we set the REST framework settings, so here I had told you, we have mentioned what is the each page size. Okay, so if you see the entry we have set is three. That means you can see only three entries in a page. That's why, so right, what Django is doing is, so it's checking. So we have mentioned the default pagination class is page number pagination. That means, I will show that also, what I've explained. You can see, this pagination style accepts a single number page in the request. So it will accept a parameter called page, and it will display those many number of entries, whatever we have configured in page size variable. So here you can see I have configured page size 3. That's why what Django automatically does is, so it knows that total number of entries are 4. Here you can see that it's displaying that also, count equal to 4. But it is not displaying all the entries in a single page. Okay, because we have set the pagination and we have set the page number of entries to be in one page to be only 3. That's why what it is doing is, it is giving us only first 3 entries and it is sending a parameter in the response. Where is the next entry? So it's in the next page 2. Here you can see the parameter is page 2. So if you see that, so here you can see there's a parameter page equal to 2. That means we have seen the first 3 entries in page and in the next page, it will send only the remaining entry. Okay. Now we can see that there is no next, it's null because we have only 4 entries. That's why there is no next page. There are only 2 pages, first page and second page. in first page we have three entries, and in second page we have only one entry. Now we can see previous is enabled. That means it will go to the previous page. So next key will point to the next page. Previous key will point to the previous page. Now
I will show you exactly again. So I will create one more author. New author two.
Okay, now there are five entries, and I will do one more change. I will change this page size to 2. Now, can you guys tell me how many there will be, how many number of total pages will be there in the response by observing this condition?
Correct.
Yeah. Yeah, perfect. Yeah. So now if you refresh this again,
so now what I did is I changed this from 3 to 2,
and now I will refresh this again. So now we can clearly see that there are only two entries in the first page, and next is enabled. I'll fetch this, and it will give the third and fourth data, and again next is enabled. But here you can see that page number is changing. Page number is changed to from 2 to 3. Okay, now I will do that. So I have got the last data. This is fifth one in the page 3. And if I want to go to next page, this is my previous page, page equal to 2. And here you can see I can pass from, I'll pass page 1. And here you can see that I can't go to the third page directly from here. I have to click on next, and I have to click on next again. Then only I can go to the page 3. So to avoid that, if I want to, so assume that I'm in page 1 right now. If I have to go to page 3, what I can do is I just have to change it here in the URL. Page equal to 3. That's it. I'll go to the last page. From first page, you can directly go to last page without clicking next or previous anything. So this is called as page number pagination. So yesterday I remember one of you had asked a question, right? How to fetch the data from any middle page. So this is the answer for this. So if you remember the page number, if you suppose assume that if you want to fetch the 20th page, what you just have to do is page equal to 20. That's like this, you should pass and you will get all the data from page 20. So right now you are getting an error because invalid page, because we have only 5 entries. So there are no 20 pages. But if you pass page 3, so I hope you got the answer, whoever asked that question yesterday. I don't remember the name, but yeah, cool, thanks. Okay, now we have tried page number pagination. Now let me try limit offset pagination. So you got the issue, you got the drawback of page number pagination, right? Because if you see page number 1, here I'm seeing only 2 entries, but right now I want 3 entries in this page. So to do that, I have to change this page size variable. Otherwise I can't make it configure in the browser directly. Unless you change something in backend, then only it will work. So this is the main drawback of page number pagination. So to avoid that, we will change it to limit offset pagination. We'll look, let's see how it resolves that issue. DRF pagination, let me import that again. So each and every documentation is available in this Django REST framework. And so whenever you get some free time, please go through this. Okay. Now I will change default pagination class to limit offset pagination. So here this is page number pagination. I will change it to limit offset pagination. Now, Now you see, so here we have enabled page size equal to 3 by default. So that's why it's displaying 3 parameters. Okay, and here you can see the values are changing, values are different here. So here we don't have page parameter, we have limit and offset parameter. So by default I had told you that limit will be 3 and offset will be 0 because we want the index from 0, and limit will be 3 by default because we have set it here, page size equal to 3, that is equivalent to limit. Page size is equivalent to limit, please remember. That's why by default whatever page size you set, that will be the value of limit, and offset will be always 0 at the beginning because we are fetching the 0th index. Now you can see that I am getting the same result, three number of entries in the first page. In page number pagination, unless I change this page size, I can't change it to 2. But here the advantage of limit offset pagination is I just have to change the limit equal to 2. You can see the number of entries are directly changed to from 3 to 2. Now you got the advantage, right? What is the advantage of limit offset pagination with respect to page number? So in page number, unless I change something here, nothing will work. The page number will be always 3. But here you just have to change the limit values. So assume that now I don't want any pagination. So there are 5 entries, right? I want all the 5 entries. So that's why I'm putting limit as 5 and offset equal to 0. You can see that I'm getting all the 5 entries in the same page. Because I increased my limit, I want all the 5 entries. But if you change it to anything, again change it to 4, you can see that I'm getting only 4 entries. And it has enabled the next page. So here you can clearly see whatever I told. The limit will be same, whatever you have done, you have enabled here, 4. But offset will be incremented by limit. So the logic is this. Offset, let me assume offset equal to 0 at beginning. To get the next page, the formula that you should use to calculate offset is, offset is offset plus limit, which is as limit equal to 4. To get the next page, how to calculate the value of offset? Offset equal to always offset plus limit. So this is the formula. So again, if you use the same thing, the next offset will be 8. Like this. So now if you click on this, the output will be offset is 4 and limit 4. That means it will go to index 4 because it has already given index 0, 1, 2, 3 in the first page. It will go to index 4 and it will try to fetch the next 4 entries. But since it has only one entry, we don't have we have only 5 objects, right? 5 entries in our table. That's why it will give only 1. Okay, this is the advantage of limit offset pagination. Okay, now we have learned about pagination. Okay, so this is with respect to get request. Now I will show you how the post request will be there. So here, let me use limit equal to 5. Okay. So okay, now we have got all the entries, right? Okay, now we have learned everything about pagination. Okay, that is done. And how to get the data, that is also done. Okay, we are getting all the data. Now let's see about other methods like this. These methods. So we have learnt about get method now. Let me explain the other four methods, how it works: post, put, delete, and patch. Now, so here you can see that one form is there, which is first name, last name, and age. So this, you might be wondering how it got generated. It is because of this view set. So this view set will automatically generate this for you, all the methods: get, post, put, patch, and delete. But here you can see that the main difference between API view and view set is, in view set you don't have to specify anything, you just have to specify your serializer class and query set, and it will do the rest, everything for you. It will, but on here in API view, you have to manually write all these methods. So if you want a post method, you have to again create one method, like define post, like this, same thing I will do, I will create also, I will show you how it looks like. This is a post method, and you should get data. So to post something to database, you should get some input, right, from the web browser, because you are creating a new entry in the author table. So that entry will be always, that data will be always stored in request.data. So request is an object, request object, and request.data contains the whole information about whatever you are passing in JSON from front end, from your web browser. And I will show you. So now what you have to do is, you have to write your create query, because you are creating the object author equal to author dot object dot create, because I'm creating the entry. So what are the things you need to create an author? You need first name, which I fetch from data of first name. I want first name key to be holding that first name value, and last name to be data of last name, and age to be data of age. So I'm fetching the data from the front end, data equal to request of data. Data holds this information, and I'm creating an entry according to that author, and I will return response after creating that. Return response message. I will send some message, acknowledgement. Author object has been created successfully. This is my acknowledgement message to my front end, to inform that author object has been created, and I'm returning a status code. I'm telling you, right? So you know what to write, what is the status code we have to send for if you create any object in the database. It should be 201 created. Status dot http. Let me copy it directly. We are a status code. So this is the status code that should be sent. So these and all, you shouldn't need, there's no need to remember. You can directly copy paste from it here. Okay. Now I'm sending a status code with this status key. Okay. Now let me test this API. Okay. So I'll open my Postman. So Postman is a tool. So this you have to install in your laptop to test your APIs. Give me a minute, it's opening. Okay, just got stuck. Just a minute. Let me close it for this while. Okay, yeah, I will test whatever I have written is correct or not here. So first I will test get method. So I will just do the same thing. The same URL I will copy paste. 8000 get all of this. I will test first. Okay, let me try sending a request. So here you can see status equal to 200. Okay, that means it's proper. The same thing, whatever we are seeing in the UI, the same thing is being written in Postman also. That means, so whatever guest request we have written, that is correct. Now let me change it to post, because I have written a post function in the same view, same class, inside the same class. If you remember, I have written one get function and one post function. Get will fetch all the authors and post will create an author, create a single author, not multiple authors, single author. So that's why, since I have defined the method as post, I should always send post request. So since I have method my method as get, so I should always send get request. That is the meaning. Okay, I will send now post request to check whether the create query, whatever we had written, that is correct or not. So how to add the data is, so in Postman, you should always use body to send data. And here you should set the data type as JSON, because as I explained already before, we are always we are using JSON here to work with API. We are using JSON format. So now what I'll do is I'll create a simple data. First name, Ashok. Okay. Last name, R. Okay. Then age equal to 30. So this is my data. Okay, I'm passing from client to my server. Okay, to create create an author inside my database. So I am giving all the required information. I'm passing all the required information that is needed to create an author from browser side, from front end side to back end. So this is my post request. I'm creating an author, and this is my URL, and this should be my HTTP request method. I told you, right? So this should post should be my request method. And okay, now I will check whether my whatever written API query, I have written the create query, right, inside this function, whether it's working or not. Let me send. Yeah. So if you remember, I had written a response called message author object has been created successfully, if you remember, in my function, inside my function. And the same thing, I'm sending it as a response. So if you are getting this response, means your API is proper. I think that key spelling mistake I done, but it's okay. Yeah, but whatever I have written, that is coming properly. And one more thing you need to observe is, here you can see status is 201 created, which is same as what I am sending from my server side. So client is also receiving the same thing. Okay, that's why I'm sending 201 created, because I have created an entry in my database. Now let's verify, cross verify this in the Django admin. Now you can see that there are 5 entries. Let me refresh and check whether what Ashok, you author, is added or not. can see Ashok has been added into the in the database, and whatever information I have added, everything is proper. Now there are total 6 entries. So whatever post API I have written, that is also perfect, because I am able to create an author inside the database. Got it? So now you are able to test both post and get. So here the same thing. So I am fetching the data object from whatever I had written from the JSON. So this data contains the whole JSON, whatever I had written inside my postman. And first name key contains Ashok, last name key contains last R, and age contains 30. Like that, the same thing I'm inserting in the respective attributes. And I'm my query is author.objects.create, and because I'm creating an object. So once this is done, it should return this response. Okay. Since my method name is post, you should always use post in postman. Since my method name is get, you should always use get. Okay. Now, okay, so now you got to see, right? Both post and test. Oh, sorry, both post and get. So are there any doubts with respect to this? Or if there is nothing else, then I'll continue. There are only 10 minutes left. I will cover one more method and I will finish the session. Okay, it's clear, right? Okay, I'll continue. Now, let's try. So now we have tried from the API view. Let me try posting the data from UseSet also, whether it's same, similar to API view or not. Aman.
Yes, sir.
Hello. Oh, sorry. I just took your name as an example. Sorry, I didn't.
Okay,
call
okay,
you.
It's fine.
Yeah. And age is 26. Okay, here you can see that what is the response? HTTP 201 created. That means same. And you can see the response also. It has created one object. And ID is 9. ID is generated by Django itself. It's primary key. And let me refresh. Yeah. Aman object, Aman author is created. Okay. So whatever we are doing here in API view as well as in Vuset, both are same. But here we should write get function and post function separately and manually from our side. And we should write how to parse the data, everything, every logic should be written from our side. Like this is custom logic. This is written from my side. But you see the advantage of UseSet. Here I haven't written anything at all. I have written only 2 lines, but it's doing all the operations, create, get, everything. So both these things, whatever I did here, whatever I had written manually, this is getting covered by UseSet by writing only 2 lines. From this only you can assume how powerful Django is. By writing only 2 lines, you are doing pagination as well as you are handling create, get, everything. You are handling it in single view set. That is the power of Django. You have written all the API directly in 2 lines. Now we have added post, right? Now let me see how to do the put or patch. So put or patch means, put means you have to update all the fields. Patch means you have to update any one or two of the fields, partial update. So let me try doing patch and put, how it looks. So now we can see there are 7 entries. Let me remove the pagination. Limit equal to alphabet as some high number. Okay, 10. Okay, I have 7 entries and I want to update this entry. I want to change the first name from Aman to something else. What should I do? To do that, Django viewset provides a simple URL. So what you should do is, this is my main viewset URL and you should enter ID of that object, primary key, because this is unique. No other person has ID 9. You can see that each and every ID of each author is different because it's primary key. Let me do like this. And once you do this, you got this Aman instance. And whatever you have written from the form, that is also you have got. And let me try changing something from here. I'll change Aman to Roshan. Okay. Let me see whether my put or patch is working or not. Yeah, it worked. Now Aman is changed to Roshan. Let me again refresh using this thing. Yeah, let me change it here only. Otherwise, I use every time I need to resize. Keep it as 10. Okay. Now here you can see that for ID 9, first name has been changed from Aman to Roshan. But you haven't defined any put method here. If you can see, you haven't written any put method, but still Django knows that what you're doing. According to that, it's creating a URL configuration. This is the power of view set, power API view. But at the end, both will do the same thing. But here you have to write everything manually. Here everything will be taken care by Django itself. That's the only difference. So this is pretty much useful if you want to create something quickly. Here you can see there you have written only 2 lines and everything is getting done by Django itself. Now you have done post, get and put. Let me try delete also. I'll do the same thing. 9. So here you can see that there is an option called delete. I'll click on this. Are you sure you want to delete this author instance? I'll click yes. Yes, it got deleted. Now I'll try refresh and I'll see. Now you can see that count has changed from 7 to 6. That means it has executed delete query author.objects.delete. You can see that there are only that Roshan author is gone. Got it? This is the power of Django viewset. So this is a raw data, JSON data, and this is an HTML form. It provides both. You can modify like JSON also, or you can modify it in form also. So both the things are possible. So now all these methods, all the 5 methods, are provided in only single 2 line, only in 2 lines by view set. But if you want to perform the same thing in API view, then you have to create 5 different methods like this. You have to create a put method and you have to write the logic to update here. And you have to write delete. Like this, you should create 5 methods. That will be time consuming, right? So viewset is a powerful tool, powerful package to do the same thing in 2 lines. So you can do use any either of this. You can use API view also, you can use viewset also. Nothing is wrong. Both are same and both will give the same output. But the way you are implementing things are different in viewset compared to API view. But the end output is same only. Yeah, so this is the concept of creating an API and testing it in Postman. Okay, I hope you understood all these things, the end-to-end thing. If you have any doubt, you can ask anything now. Otherwise, there is only one single thing at the end that I will cover. It is just a theory. So with respect to practical things, Everything is done. So if you can ask any doubt, you can ask now. Otherwise, we have 3 minutes. I'll quickly try to cover the last topic. I'll give 1 minute. Please think and let me know if you have any doubt. Okay, I hope you understood everything. You can try it in your home and let me know if you face any issues with respect to setup or anything. I hope you took the notes of all these things, what I have done till now. And let me go to the last thing, paginations and sockets. So whatever we have done till now, that is with respect to HTTP call. That means first client, that means your web browser will send a request and your server, which is Django, will respond. That means the one cycle is completed. That means it's a HTTP protocol itself. So in HTTP protocol, always clients should send a request to server. Then only server can respond. So here you can see that without sending request, we are not sending the response directly. So if you want to view something, you always have to refresh. The information will not be refreshed immediately by Django. Once, whenever you make a request to this URL, then only it will send the updated content. That means, so whenever client sends the data, clients make a request, then only server can respond. Server cannot respond directly without client sending any request. That is the protocol of HTTP. But the main drawback of this HTTP is, so assume that a chat application, assume WhatsApp only. So in WhatsApp, you have seen that whenever someone sends a message, it will send a notification in your mobile notification bar. And the information will be updated immediately. Whenever you open the WhatsApp, you can see that there is one new message like that. But if you use HTTP, for this, that is not possible to design this kind of chat application, because in HTTP, whenever you make a refresh, whenever you refresh the screen, then only the information will get upgraded, because you are sending a request and server is sending a response. This is a cycle, but it cannot be reversed. Like server will send a request first, then will client respond. It will not be like that. Every time, client will only make the request first, then server will respond. But this system, this protocol will not be useful in chat application, because there the information has to be refreshed instantaneous. Like you shouldn't expect the user will make a refresh every time whenever he wants to get any new message. It should be updated immediately. To do that, you should use WebSockets. So WebSockets protocol, socket protocol, it's different to HTTP protocol. So in WebSocket, what happens is, whenever clients make a request first, it will open an event, like it will open a connection between client and server. And that connection will be hold till it will be continuously getting hold by both the server and client. So once the connection is open, anyone can send data to anyone. Client also can send some information to server. Server can also send some information to client. So they can mutually exchange information with themselves. It's not like client will send a request first and server will send response at cache. It was not like HTTP. Whenever that connection is still open, both the parties, client and server, can exchange the information. And both client and server can respond at the same time. It's possible in WebSocket. That connection will get closed whenever any one of them, like server wants to close the connection, or the client wants to close the connection, then only that connection will be closed. But in HTTP, once the response is sent, that one cycle is completed. then the next one, what you are doing, it will be a new request. So here it's not like that. Once the connection is open, you can send multiple requests through that connection, and server can also send multiple responses. So it's not a cycling thing. So until that connection gets closed, both the parties can do anything. So this is the advantage of WebSockets over HTTP. So whenever you design some chat kind of application at all, you shouldn't use HTTP at all, because HTTP will not be useful in chat applications. So in that cases, you should always use WebSockets. Yeah, that is the main advantage of WebSockets over HTTP. But if you are designing some application which is where real-time update is not required, real-time information is not required, like some kind of blog or some kind of any application which is not chat kind of application, in that case you can always use HTTP. So that is perfectly fine. But this is the main difference between HTTP and WebSockets. Yeah, that's it from my side. Thank you. So if you have any questions, you can ask anything. Otherwise, we can close the session. So I'll give 2 minutes. Please think and let me know if you have anything to ask, anything with the setup, anything, any doubts you have, you can ask. Okay, over to you.
So thank you, Nikhil sir, for this wonderful and enlightening session. And I hope we all got to learn a lot. So thanks for that. If anybody has any question, you can ask to Dimton Thil sir, since this is going to be the last day of our workshop.
Okay, no queries. Yeah, welcome.
Okay, then.
Please try to implement these things from your side, and please try it out from your side. Then only when you face some issues, then only you'll get to know how to fix it. So I request you guys to write by your own in your personal laptop, so that you can learn a lot of things. So as I told, so there is a website, DRF, I had told, right? So if you go to this Django REST framework website, so here everything, whatever I told till now, everything is documented properly. So you can take this as a reference to learning, for your learning. So whatever I explained till now, this covers only a part of the API. So if you want to explore advanced things, you can do it. Okay. Okay. Sure. Okay. Over to you, Vikram and Aman.
Thank you, sir. So if Vikram sir or Nikhil sir doesn't have anything else to add, then I guess we could conclude the workshop.